So welcome everybody, welcome to the first introductory class for cognitive behavior therapy. I wish I could be with you today, but unfortunately I can't. But through the combination of this miraculous technology and with Molly, and Molly's about to graduate senior clinical student, we'll be able to get through this. So I want to give you my version of CBT. And my version is probably different than the one that you read about in textbooks or that you even would research, because it involves looking at CBT nested within two other sort of concentric rings, nested within an interpersonal relationship with a client, which is extremely important. And sometimes CBT doesn't talk about that. We talk mainly about the technique that we're doing, whether it's relaxation or in vivo exposure or whatever else. But we don't talk about the interpersonal relationship with a client that allows that technique to be successful or even implemented. And the third area that I'd like to address is the organizational aspect, is that no therapy is delivered without an organizational context. You're working in a clinic, or that clinic is embedded in a hospital, or you're working in a CLSC, or even in private practice, and in private practice, the context is the marketplace. So those contextual organizational factors are extremely important, and I'd like to sort of provide examples from my career and argue that case. And the interpersonal and organizational aspects, I would argue, are relatively ignored in discussion of cognitive behavior therapy. So in this course, they're going to be emphasized rather than to be ignored. So let me start at the beginning, and all beginnings start with a definition. And if you go to the first page of the lecture notes, you'll read, I think I have five definitions of cognitive behavior therapy. And you know when that happens that there's a problem, right? Because if we need five definitions of something, it means that none of them are very good. It's like going into a bookstore and having 1,000 books on dieting. If we need 1,000 books, then there's a problem. And the definitions vary from the very limited and strict definitions, such as cognitive behavior therapy is the application of principles of learning, for example. So you take a principle of learning, which is classical conditioning, and then you build a technique on that, such as systematic desensitization, and that's cognitive behavior therapy. So it's based on a theory of learning or conditioning. Or some definitions just stress the idea that it's a whole amalgam of various techniques, and the list of techniques, such as exposure, response prevention, or mindfulness, or whatever the technique is. And if you do any one of those techniques, then it's cognitive behavior therapy. As you go along the definitions, they get more comprehensive, but then they get vague and perhaps too inclusive. Nonetheless, I tend to go to the more generalized definitions such as, in general, CBT is based on a scientific foundation in the sense that we try to evaluate the techniques that we're employing. We tend to measure the client at the beginning of therapy and at the end of therapy, and we employ techniques that have some empirical validation, so it's scientifically based. It's also pragmatic in the sense that we try to do something in the real world to help somebody. It has perhaps more of an emphasis on the present than past historical factors. But I think all those definitions pale to the definition that I like, and surprisingly enough, I didn't put that definition in notes. My definition is that it's the application of techniques and principles of a psychology creatively applied to solve problems. So again, it's quite general. I think it's learning a lot about psychology, applying things from social psychology or neuropsychology or learning theory or whatever, and applying those things to in a creative way to solve problems in living. I think one of the problems with that definition is that it goes against the current zeitgeist in psychology, especially clinical psychology, which has developed very narrow areas of specialization. Because I would argue that the more you know as a cognitive behavior therapist about psychology, the better therapist you're going to be. But the problem is, once you graduate and you become accredited, then you're placed in a narrow field of specialization. For example, if you even specialize in OCD, you might specialize just in people that have fears of contamination. Or if you're involved in anxiety disorders, you might just specialize in panic disorder or agoraphobia. And in addition to that, professional groups tend to put up barriers so that it's very difficult to learn or even employ techniques in that field. So neuropsychology would be one example. When I was a graduate student many years ago, neuropsychology was just part of the training of a clinical psychologist. And so we were taught about the measurement of attention, for example, and we would apply that to attentional dysfunctions in schizophrenia or attentional dysfunctions in autism. But now that seems to be part of neuropsychology, and unless you're an accredited neuropsychologist with specialized training, then you can't do any attentional testing and you should maybe ignore those variables. So it goes against a bit of the zeitgeist, the way clinical psychology is practiced, which I think is unfortunate. So that's what I want to say about a definition. The idea that you can have very narrow ones that can apply to some of the field, but the more general ones I think are more apt, but the problem is that they are inclusive of a lot of things that probably are not cognitive behavior therapy. Let me go to my second point, which is I believe that there's a disconnect between the way universities teach cognitive behavior therapy and the way it's researched versus the way it's practiced. And this schism is not entirely unknown in the world of academia. For example, if you were in law school, you would be taught mostly by professors who don't practice, who are experts in principles of law, but have very little experience in the courtroom, or in litigation, or in drawing up contracts. And that's probably true in a large measure in clinical psychology. If you go into a doctoral program in clinical psychology, regrettably, most of the people that are teaching are not licensed to practice. And they might have practiced early on in their training, but few of them do right now. They're experts in research, of course, and that's great. But you have this schism between the world of the people that are teaching the material versus the world of people that are practicing it and on a daily basis. The research is also, I think, different, and there's a disconnect. The research is really focused on homogeneous patient populations. So you have a group of depressed patients that are assessed, or a group of OCD patients, or a group of people that are suicidal. So homogeneous target problems, and you come up with an intervention, or most likely a package of interventions, techniques, and then you evaluate that in a group setting where the therapy is manualized. You write down on paper very specifically what you're doing, and you can compare that group treatment to other treatments for that same target problem. And again, there are people in the world of private practice who deal in groups, but not many. Most private patients are reluctant to go into a group. Most of the groups you find in hospitals and not in private practice. And in addition, the problems that I see in my private practice are extremely mixed and varied. They don't fall into a homogeneous group. For example, a lot of my practice, if you go to my website and you'll discover, involves dealing with professional athletes. So there are no manualized programs to deal with a second baseman who's in a slump, or an athlete that's been caught having an affair because Saturday night after the game they're in a foreign city and they're in a bar and all kinds of bad things happen at 3 o'clock in the morning. So there are no manualized programs for that. I also spend a lot of time dealing with the psychology of the workplace. So I deal with CEOs, perhaps, who are distracted because they're going through a divorce, or CEOs that have problems in leadership and are wondering, how do they create a culture where people are stimulated and motivated to work? And again, you're not going to find those kind of treatment manuals. The problems are problems in living, and rarely are the kind of problems that I encounter in private practice the focus of research, because you can't get homogeneous groups of people. You're not going to get 10 athletes who are going through a marital dysfunction as a result of, I don't know, excessive drinking. So that's a slant that I bring, and when you read the research and when you read textbooks, it seems that all the programs are cut and dry, that this is the treatment program for an agoraphobic person, and this is a treatment program for somebody who's lacking in social skills, and those things exist. I use part of those manualized programs, but very rarely is there a patient that comes across my door, my clinical door, where there is a focal problem. I can just get a manual, which means that I rely on other things. I rely on my experience, I rely on general principles of psychology, common sense, and my own values, or whatever. Let me talk about interventions, and again have this idea of a layer with interventions, so that there are specific interventions like social skills training or exposure, and those are the things I mentioned before that are investigated. But what I find is really important in my practice is, again, something that's not discussed, and that's language. And using the appropriate word or using the appropriate metaphor to describe the patient's problem. So I remember one time I helped somebody, I asked them at the end of the session what they found helpful, or at the end of seeing them four or five times, what did they find helpful? And sometimes the person says to me, you know, it's what you said to me, like I'm digging my own hole. Or one woman recalled that I said to her at one point, you know, you took me back and you were so right when you said to me that I'm not prepared for winning. I'm not prepared for victory. And this was a woman who was in an organization. She made a sexual harassment complaint against her boss, and it was being investigated, but the investigation was laborious and stressful. And she was convinced that the outcome of the process would, that she would lose and she would be fired. And she was ruminating about that and not sleeping. And my experience, and both in the workplace and my experience as an individual, is that she's going to win. There's no doubt about it, but she's going to win her case, but her boss is going to be, if the boss is still there, is going to be angry at her, and she's going to have to deal with that, and that's going to be the relevant issue. So understanding the issue and phrasing it back to the client in a way that recognizes that you're understanding on the same page as the client, and summarizing it in a way that leads to change. I mean, those kinds of things that represent the bulk of the kind of CBT that I would do are not mentioned, they're not discussed, they're certainly not researched, but they're a very important part of therapy. What is discussed, however, and more so, is the therapeutic style. The idea that how you relate to a client. Although I agree that it's important to be empathetic and understanding and congruent and all those great things that derive from client-centered therapy, I think, though, that other factors are important. I tend to use humor in my therapy. I tend to laugh with clients. I think that's really important. And again, that's not discussed. It's not talked about, use of humor. I tend to be direct as well. I tend to speak my mind honestly and react honestly. If somebody asked me a question about my opinion about something, I would tell them, or I wouldn't hesitate to give somebody actionable advice. So oftentimes when CBT talks about this interpersonal style, they talk about a purely democratic, cooperative, mutually reinforcing style where there's empathy and whatever else, but I think there's more to it than that, and it probably changes from one therapist to another. Another thing that's important, I think, in my therapy as a cognitive behavior therapist is the fact that I don't have hair, in the sense that I'm old, and as a result of that, I have experiences. And so, for example, in part of my life, I was a tennis pro, teaching beginners how to play tennis. I was in tennis tournaments nationally. And so when somebody talks about pressure, somebody talks about taking a penalty shot, for example, in soccer, or penalty shot in hockey, and having all the eyes focused on them and the outcome, I have a feeling of that. I can sort of relate to that. When somebody talks about going through a divorce, I wouldn't advocate this as a general strategy, but I have been divorced, and so I understand what's involved. I think one's experience in life is a really important factor in being a good cognitive behavior therapist. And again, that's not something people talk about. I've been a part owner of various businesses, so I'm familiar with the world of work. I'm an investor myself, so I'm familiar with some of the issues in behavioral economics and some of the biases that we have in terms of how we deal with money. So regardless of your experience, and that's one thing that I would advocate for all young people, is that everything counts. It's not just what you do in psychology, it's not just what you do to prepare for your research, for your doctoral defense, it's what you do in life that's so important. And hanging out with people and doing all kinds of things is fodder for being a good therapist. So let me go on to something else right now. I wanted to talk a little bit about the timeline of cognitive behavior therapy. I wanted to talk about how it developed, what its historical roots in learning theory with Pavlov, with the application of behaviorism with Watson, how it changed with Skinner, how from Skinner we developed specific interventions in behavior therapy, and then cognitive therapy evolved from that, and now what we have is this so-called third wave of experiential therapy, where we delve into people's consciousness and we try to discourage avoidance of painful emotional material. So I wanted to talk about that, but I wanted to talk about it, if you don't mind, in terms of my own career, to give you some personal experience with this. And so let me start at the beginning and tell you about my education. I was accepted into probably the best clinical psychology program in Canada at the University of Waterloo. In fact, it was the only program accredited by the American Psychological Association. And we had a faculty of very well-known and internationally renowned people in psychology, and some of the founders of cognitive behavior therapy, in particular Don Meichenbaum. So I was extremely fortunate to get in, and the joke of it is that I got in I was accepted without ever having a course in psychology, which is now ludicrous. I mean, I graduated with an honors degree in biochemistry. I did a master's degree in physiology at U of T. And I realized that I was not going to be a great physiologist, and it wasn't clear as to what I wanted to do. And just along the way, I happened to volunteer at a treatment center for emotionally disturbed kids in Toronto, and got sort of turned on by the world of treatment and psychology and whatever. And then there was a psychologist at Waterloo in the clinical program who was interested in psychophysiology, interested in looking at people's stress reaction when they were, he actually studied skydivers, and he studied their physiological responses. They were hanging on the wing and dropping out, and measuring skin conductance response and heart rate and blood pressure and things like that. And so he looked at my background and said, this guy could help, and I managed to get in. So it goes a little bit to probably some of the things that you're thinking right now in terms of where you want to go in terms of a career. And if I had advice for people, for young people like you, well, first of all, I wanted to say that that it's an unfortunate kind of dilemma that you're in, because I think you're selecting, if you elect to go into clinical psychology, I think you're selecting a career without very much information about what clinical psychologists do. And so you're making a judgment about, this is the path that I want to take. And your information about the profession, I think, is minimal at best. Don't want to be insulting, but I don't think you know what it's like to be a clinical psychologist. You have perhaps a sense of what it's like to be a university researcher in psychology. Perhaps you worked in a research lab, but I don't think many of you have an idea what it's like to be a clinician and to deal with patients and to be in private practice. But nonetheless, that's appealing to you, and it's quite a dilemma as to choose something with such little information. And so how do you know you're going to be happy? How do you know you're going to be right, in quotes? So I would like to reassure you that you don't have to be right, and that it is an impossible choice, and that the world is much more plastic than you imagine. And psychology is a great field because it can be applied in all kinds of areas. When I enrolled at the University of Waterloo in clinical, I was convinced that I was going to be a child psychologist. I did my internship later on at the Kennedy Child Study Center in Los Angeles, and I did work. I ran a treatment center for autistic kids for 1 year, and that was it. After that, I never saw another kid in my life except for my own. So you never know. And doors open, possibilities emerge, and psychology allows you to move from one specialty or one target population or one organization to the next. It's a rich, rich field. So I would tell people, relax. You don't have to plan it all, that you can jump from one area to another. And train broadly. Don't follow my path of thinking that I have to do every clinical experience with child. Do something that you maybe don't like in order to gain experience with it and find out what it's all about. So let me talk a little bit more about my own training. Because my training, my first internship experience, it was a summer internship when I was at Waterloo, and this was the early 1970s, involved placement in clinics that were really behavior therapy clinics. These clinics were embedded in a mental hospital that no longer exists. It's called Lakeshore Psychiatric Hospital in Toronto, but there were two clinics, one that was run by a psychologist doing systematic desensitization, and another one was an inpatient ward run again by a psychologist who had developed what's called a token economy program for the chronic patients on that ward. So both of those programs followed the classic definition of behavior therapy. This is long before cognitive therapy was developed. So they used principles of learning in systematic desensitization, for example. We train people in relaxation, and then we paired through Pavlovian conditioning the relaxation response or stimulus with a phobic object. And we did this in imagination with patients until they reported that they didn't have any fear. So if you can imagine, a woman was frightened of going in the metro, and we would imagine her going in the metro when she was relaxed, and she would imagine that over hours and hours and hours. We might even jazz it up by measuring their heart rate or skin conductance, finding out that over time their arousal decreased. So I was doing that, and then I was in a ward as well where we're rewarding people for getting dressed, for having pro-social conversations with tokens that they could reward for good stuff. So it was classical behavior therapy, the application of principles of, in the first case, classical conditioning, in the second place, rewarding them with operant conditioning principles. But the major emphasis at that time in psychology was testing. And most psychologists employed in the mental hospital were doing psychological testing. And it was a boring, in my opinion, relatively useless activity where people gave IQ tests to patients. They gave them a projective test, you know, the Rorschach test, the inkblot test, and maybe an objectively scored test of personality like the MMPI. And then after 3 hours of seeing the person would write a report and who would read the report. I'm not really sure, and how the report was utilized in the care of the patient, again, I wasn't terribly clear. But nonetheless, most of the psychologists employed were doing that. The minority were doing treatment using behavior principles, but most of the principles and most of the techniques were boring. I almost dropped out because I don't know if you can imagine training somebody in relaxation one after another and then getting sitting there as they're imagining the snake or the metro or the airplane or whatever. So when cognitive therapy came along, and it came along in Waterloo early on, as I said, Waterloo and Meckelbaum were one of the pioneers of cognitive behavior therapy, this whole area opened up and suddenly we could talk to patients and we could relate to them and ask them what they were feeling and what their ideas were. And we worked on changing their ideas. So again, it was a breath of fresh air, and there was a revolution in terms of spirit and also research. And a whole variety of target problems opened up that didn't open up before, in particular depression. Huge numbers of patients that we didn't see before we're able to see right now because we talked about their hopelessness, their sense of pessimism, their criticism, their needless criticism of themselves. I went after graduation. I needed to do an internship, a four-year internship, and I went, as I said, to California and did internship in the Kennedy Child Study Center. And regrettably, again, if psychologists weren't doing psychological testing, the therapy they were doing, if they weren't doing cognitive therapy, was psychoanalytically oriented therapy, which I felt difficult to do with kids. And the typical scenario was that you would do play therapy. So you would bring a child in, a child who is oppositional disorder or something, having temper tantrums, fighting with other kids. And you would have a constant set of toys in the room. And the child would play with the toy. And hopefully something would happen that would reflect their problem in the real world. And then you would comment on it and say, oh, gee, you seem to have a lot of anger. Or would you like to tell me more about why you hate that teacher or that whatever? But it was all so indirect and I found it slow and passive, and I wasn't sure that it was very helpful at all. So I was happy when I graduated that I could get more active, and I was the chief psychologist at a treatment center, the only one in BC dealing with autistic kids. And that was a great experience for me because we employed, again, operant conditioning principles in a miraculous way to take kids that were without language, without any kind of functional speech whatsoever, and were able to give them language and that they could use in a pro-social way, as well as train them in self-care habits such as eating and dressing skills that were beyond them. So it was a miraculous kind of treatment. And I learned a couple of things that were really important for me. One is that, well, generalization doesn't happen. If you train somebody to do something in one environment, it doesn't necessarily generalize to another. So if you're training someone to be assertive in the therapy situation with you as a therapist, it doesn't mean that they're going to be automatically assertive and speak their mind to their boss or to their spouse. That you need to bridge that gap between the training or therapy environment and the real world environment. The other thing I learned and that was really important is the importance of environment and context and structure. If you leave an autistic child alone, nothing happens. Only bad things happen. They spin or twirl or self-stimulate or whatever. So every minute of the day has to be structured. And that really helped me when I work with inpatients and psychiatric inpatients, because in that environment, in my experience, most of the day is unstructured. And most of the day is spent watching television or regrettably smoking or, you know, lining up to take medication. So autism, dealing with autistic kids, really was an important aspect in my own training and development, and really emphasized the importance of the environment or the context. I then went to Douglas Hospital, and I was recruited by a McGill professor. He's just died in the last couple of years, but his name was Ernest Poser. And he was the first psychologist to develop a cognitive behavior therapy clinic in Montreal. And he did it at the Douglas Hospital, and it was a great experience of being there. We were five psychologists, and we worked independently. We had our own little cottage building, and it was a great time. But let me tell you about how Dr. Poser conducted rounds. He was a pioneer and a marvelous guy and whatever, but he had one question that he would ask when a case was presented. We would not take turns seeing new intakes and then present them to the team, and then Ernest Poser would ask, is this an appropriate case for behavior therapy or cognitive behavior therapy? And invariably, and not invariably, but maybe 7 times out of 10, it was deemed to be not an appropriate case, either because the patient was too disorganized or had psychotic symptoms or whatever. But I'd like to bring this up to you as an example of an organizational factor that was responsible for the demise of the clinic. Yeah, and I don't know if you can see why, but this clinic was viewed as elitist. We were five PhD psychologists in the middle of a mental hospital of 1,000 patients at that time, in wards that were relatively deprived of psychologists, tremendously overworked people, dealing with hardcore chronic patients. And we were putting up barriers in the organization saying that we didn't think this person was appropriate for the treatment. Well, after years of that, and they finally closed the clinic and saying, what's the purpose of it, and how are you fitting into the larger organizational needs of the mission of the Douglas Hospital? So it's the idea that organizational factors are important, and you have to pay attention to them. After that, I was, and this is the last stage in my career, I was appointed chief psychologist, and I applied and got the job. And it's funny because I wanted it, I guess, because it was a promotion and it was sounded sort of prestigious to be chief psychologist, but I was completely unprepared. I was completely unaware of the challenges that I would face, and then quickly became overwhelmed with it. Nobody had prepared me to be in the middle between administration, who was running the hospital, who were saying, I want you to cut costs, I want you to respect your budget, and below me, PhD psychologists who wanted to do more things, who wanted to work in a particular area, or who wanted to do psychological testing, where I didn't want them to do testing, I wanted them to do cognitive behavior therapy. So managing people, dealing with organizational issues, something that I was completely unprepared to do. And so what helped me is that after a couple of years, I took night courses in the MBA program in Con Ed at McGill, and that gave me some grounding and realization that these issues that I thought were just sort of office politics are actually objects of study and academic inquiry, and that you don't have to reinvent the wheel. So I would encourage each of you to take courses in business and organizational design or human resources or organizational behavior to make sure that you're not as unprepared as I am in dealing with some of these challenges. And again, I was lucky because at that time when I was appointed chief psychologist, I think it was 1981, behavior therapy was relatively a backwater. Cognitive behavior therapy existed, but there are very few people that were practicing it. And you say, well, why is that an advantage? Because the market was vacant, that we could move into it, we in terms of the Department of Psychology, and without competition. So we started off with, I think, 4 psychologists who were interested in doing cognitive behavior therapy, and we grew that team to 50 over the course of 20 years. And we developed clinics in anxiety disorders and panic and OCD and sexual dysfunctions and depression, all run by psychologists, all conducted from the Department of Psychology, all evaluated, many of them manualized. So it was real fun. And that when we could do it, because as I said, the marketplace was relatively vacant, that tended not to stay that way. Over the about the 1990s, psychiatry became very much interested in cognitive behavior therapy, mainly because it was empirical and they were tired of psychoanalysis and they wanted something that was more tangible and down to earth. So becoming a cognitive behavior therapist, and of course the work of Beck, who was a psychiatrist himself, stimulated those people as well. So at the end, I think everybody became a cognitive behavior therapist. Most psychiatrists who weren't involved in psychopharmacology were cognitive behavior therapists. Social workers that had taken a six-month training program in cognitive behavior therapy were cognitive behavior therapists, according to them. Nurses who read a manualized treatment program were occupational therapists who bought manuals about how to deal with social skills training, became cognitive behavior therapists. And so again, the field became crowded and territorial competition arose. And at the end, it was a very different environment. For the last 10 years, because I left the hospital about 10 years ago, I've been involved in the area of professional athletes. 50% of my practice involves athletes. Another good chunk of it involves business. I deal as a consultant with small businesses and family businesses, dealing with workplace issues, especially people on workplace disability. Although I do continue to see some of the people with focal problems, but again, it's the minority. So in this course, what we're going to do is talk about, especially in terms of the group assignments and the presentations, we're going to be talking about some of the organizational aspects that are going to give you a chance to be creative. The quizzes that we're going to have are going to be directly sort of party line cognitive behavior therapy, so memorization of names and ideas and concepts and whatever else. But we're going to switch gears and be more like private practitioners when we do the group presentations. Getting you to think about a problem in a different way, getting you to think outside the box, giving you experience with some of the techniques. So I want to bring that emphasis, and also to talk about the world of work, because regardless of where you're going to work, you're going to be working in a workplace context. I'm going to be talking about that. So let me stop there, and Molly is going to answer any questions that you have. But what I would like you to do right now is get into a group of two or three people, well, three people, and discuss what experiences you had in life, not necessarily in psychology, you can talk about the psychology experiences you've had, but the ones in life, part-time jobs or experiences as a volunteer, that you think you could draw upon in a later career. And that career could be in psychology or another thing. So do that, ask Molly some questions, and then I'll be back in a couple minutes. Thanks. Okay, so I'm back, guys, and what I thought I'd do in the next 20 minutes is just talk about my lecture handouts. These are not meant to be a flowing book-like narrative description. It's to highlight certain points of the lecture and to summarize them and to give you certain names and concepts, but it requires that you go to extra sources and read about things that aren't terribly clear, that you go to a textbook of CBT and supplement the information. But nonetheless, this will form the nucleus of the material that we're going to use for the quizzes. So if you're asking the all-important question, what's on the exam, the answer to that is this. So not the material that we're going to talk in the group assignments and not the presentations you do, but all the exams, except the final one, will be related to material from here. So let me just quickly review this and not read it, because hopefully you have read it or will read it. I went through the definitions of cognitive behavior therapy on the first page, and we talked about historical development. I want to make the case that I'm not sure that, even though I charge a lot of money for people to come to see me, I'm not sure that my advice is any more sophisticated than what you could get from your grandmother. There are very, very few things that cognitive behavior therapists say that are unique. In fact, I would argue that our source of wisdom rests in antiquity. So I've got some quotes that you can read. Cowards die many times before their deaths. The valiant never taste death but once. Julius Caesar. So what was he talking about? He was talking about the idea of the importance of negative thoughts, and that you can scare yourself with your own negative thoughts, and that sometimes testing out reality is not as bad as you think it is. But these are not new ideas, guys. These are not new concepts. Cognitive behavior therapy, although I like to think about it as creative, it's not something completely divorced from mainstream culture and historical folklore. It's not that we're going to be burning candles in your ears or asking you to find your poles in your abdomen or go and move your eyeballs back and forth. We're not going to do weird things like that. It's really the application of commonsensical techniques. Where did behavior therapy start? Well, let me give you the party line view. So behavior therapy started with Watson. And Watson drew upon the work, the translated work, of Pavlov. Pavlov obviously worked in Russian, and his work was translated by a guy called Yerkes, who's familiar, if you've done primate research, you know about the Yerkes lab. But in any event, Watson read Pavlov and said, we could use the notion of Pavlovian conditioning, or classical or respondent conditioning, the idea that we take a stimulus with meaning and we pair it to something that doesn't have meaning, that kind of associative learning, and that we could do two things with that. We could develop a research methodology and we could understand human behavior. Well, why was this a big revolution? What's the big deal? Because when Watson wrote his book, 1911, Psychology as a Behaviorist saw it, it really was a revolution. Well, what were psychologists doing before Watson? Well, what they were doing was they weren't even called psychologists, they were called philosophers. There weren't any departments of psychology. Psychology was a subdivision of philosophy. And what did they study, those psychologists, philosophers? They studied consciousness. And that was following the work of the German school of psychology, led by a person you might have heard about, Wundt, who thought that Wundt was very much influenced by the development in the physical sciences at that time. For example, if you go around the campus downtown, I still think they have the building called the Rutherford Building. And Rutherford, at the turn of the last century, discovered the atom. And he discovered the idea that matter, trees, beings, rocks, can be deconstructed and subdivided to the smallest unit, and the smallest unit is an atom. So he discovered the atom, discovering the nucleus, and then the space and the electron shell. So he was able to reduce complex matter to the smallest ingredient. And Wundt and the introspectionists said, this is the way to go. This is what we need to do in psychology. We need to take that kind of methodology, and perhaps complex thinking, ideas and emotions are built on atomistic kind of sensory experiences. So we'll get people, expert people, who will train, who will report on their sensations. And by the way, when I meant a sensation, they could talk about what their hunger felt like, or what it felt like when they were listening to a metronome, or what it felt like when they were, I don't know, confused about a topic. So basic sensations of life, can you describe them? And from these, we'll build up, from the ground up, like the atoms, we'll build up the nucleus, the electron shell, and we'll get to explain complex events like philosophy and complex behavior. Watson said, this is garbage. We're not going to do that. One, the report of these introspectionists is completely biased. It reflects maybe their own thinking. And probably things, complex behavior, can't be divided up on the basis of pure sensations to simple stimuli. So he objected to this sort of methodology and said that we need in psychology to do experiments, and we need to do experiments on behavior that we see, behavior that's observable, something that we can quantify and observe. And so from that, he developed what is called, and what we call now, an operational definition of something. So what do we mean by when a client comes in and they say, I'm depressed or I'm sad? What's my question? I would say, what do you mean by that? Tell me more about that. And so what I'm trying to do is operationally define in very specific terms, deconstruct that concept into behaviors that we can recognize. So that's what Watson said that we should do. We should do experiments. We need to do experiments. The only way to do it is with operational definition of behavior. So that tradition has expanded, and it's now so much a part of society that we don't even think about it. We don't even realize that it came from Watson. What happens when we go to a restaurant and we're presented at the end of the meal with a card saying, how do you rate the meal? How do you measure your satisfaction with this meal? Or when you buy a car and you get in the mail from Toyota a month later, are you happy with the car? So they're taking happiness or a meal sensation and they're operationally defining it into the sub ingredients that can be behaviorally defined. So that's just a part of society that we take for granted right now, but all of that came from Watson. The second part of Watson's work was a complete bust because he tried to explain behavior in terms of classical conditioning. He tried to say that all complex behavior can be explained as a clustered series of conditioned responses, and he used respondent conditioning to try to do this. And I've given an example where he tried to do this on page, as I try to flip here, page 4. And you can see that in terms of trying to explain how people develop, how they learn to play the piano, associating a visual stimulus of a key to a sound, and then linking that sound to the next key and whatever. I don't think that's the way people learn to play the piano, and most people rejected it. The interesting thing about Watson is that he was quite a cantankerous kind of dogmatic person, and perhaps he needed to be to cause this revolution in psychology. That's something that I'd like to argue that's really neglected when we talk about psychology and about CBT, which is the importance of the personalities of the people that are advocating these ideas, because the ideas are not just ideas, but they come from a salesperson. And it's the quality of that salesmanship that's really important. And for Watson, he was, you can read some of his quotes, he was quite audacious or bombastic, depending on your point of view, in terms of what he thought he could do with classical conditioning. So there's this one quote that, I can turn anybody, you allow me to control their lives in terms of the stimuli, and I can make them into a doctor or a lawyer or a criminal or whatever, by changing the environmental stimuli that they're confronted with. So this idea of explaining everything through classical conditioning didn't really work, but the methodology changed psychology and changed society. Just as a side note, it's interesting more about the personality of Watson is that he actually left academia as a result of having an affair. You see, it's not so much that he had an affair, it's that he had an affair with the daughter of the president of the university, which is, if you're going to have an affair as a faculty member, that's not the right person to choose. It wasn't a death knell to his career because he went and then joined a very famous advertising agency, J. Walter Thompson, in the United States at the time in the 1950s. It was the most important advertising agency and developed all kinds of commercials. And as I said in the notes, I know it, and maybe your parents know it, the commercial that ends in good to the last drop, a coffee commercial, and that was his line. So he became famous in the world of advertising. The next historical person I'd like to talk about briefly is Skinner, and you could read about his work and how he changed the emphasis from classical conditioning to operant conditioning. And that was the American tradition, by the way. Watson, when he adopted respondent conditioning, was going against the zeitgeist of North American psychology at the time, which is Thorndike's law of effect and the importance of reinforcement. So Watson was battling a lot of people, including a lot of North American psychologists, but Skinner used Thorndike's law of effect and tried to explain behavior in terms of eliciting stimuli, but more importantly in terms of reinforcing stimuli that came after the behavior. And he developed, and his colleagues then developed, this SRR, stimulus response reinforcement, as theories, and you can read about his notion of what was called radical behaviorism, which is the idea that you can explain all behavior in terms of contingencies, either historical contingencies, current contingencies, reinforcement, or evolutionary ones, that this is good for our survival. It led to an adaptation in our survival, and that's why it's important. Well, radical behaviorism is characterized by all these sort of philosophical attributes that make great fodder for academic quiz questions, and I'll let you read them. You could describe radical behaviorism as following a philosophy of realism versus cognitive behavior therapy that is constructivism, that we're talking about creating the world and developing meaning, whereas behavior therapy assumes that there is meaning out there, that there's an objective reality. Pragmatism, positivism. Positivism doesn't mean the idea about optimism. It's not that you're a happy person. Positivism, in terms of psychology, means the idea that knowledge comes from experimentation, that knowledge is verifiable, that knowledge doesn't come from a guru, from somebody that's getting you to drink Kool-Aid and love somebody else because I'm the master, or it doesn't come from religion or tradition. But positivism means that the information is coming from veritable observation and scientific knowledge. You have these other isms, determinism, and for all these things, a typical question that I would ask you is that show how behavior therapy technique, like systematic desensitization, for example, is based on associationism, or the importance of operationalism, that we talked about that before. Another ism that's really important is this notion of contextualism, and that's a key aspect of radical behaviorism, the idea that a behavior doesn't exist except that it's embedded in its context. So you don't have a disruptive angry child, you have a disruptive angry child embedded in a disruptive classroom or embedded in a maladaptive interaction in the family. So it's not just the behavior of the individual. The behavior of the individual is inseparable from the context, the environmental context in which the behavior is occurring. And that's a unique idea from behaviorism. So functionalism, I'll let you talk about that and the two meanings of functionalism. When I list names, and I do that on page 8, the ones that are in bold I think are really important for you to know, and the other ones are optional, so I'd never ask you about their contributions if the name is not in bold. So all this then led to this first wave of behavior therapy, the application of classical conditioning or operant conditioning procedures to treat people. Systematic desensitization would be an example of an application of classical conditioning. Token economy program, where you reward people with tokens, for example, in an inpatient setting would be an example of operant conditioning application. Let me tell you about some of the history, and I from my first talk, you know that behavior therapy sort of was greeted by other professions with great skepticism, saying that it wasn't deep, especially even psychologists who were involved in testing, because they would give Rorschachs or inkblots to people, conclude all kinds of hypothetical but overarching conclusions about their personality, and argue that behavior therapy was limited in its superficial analysis to what people could see, and that was not the essence of the behavior. So there was a lot of criticism, and you can read on page 9 where behavior therapy stood and some of the objections to it. And then along probably in the 1970s, and it happened in various places at various times, but the second wave developed of cognitive therapy, which is looking at cognitions, looking at people's ideas, their assumptions, looking at errors in thinking. So overgeneralization, concluding that because one person doesn't like you, that nobody likes you. Or concluding that after you failed your stats exam, that you're going to fail everything. So generalizations like that. So identifying the maladaptive cognition and then trying to go and replace it with something that's more adaptive. So disputing, Socratic questioning, doing thought experiments, all things that we're going to talk later on, reflect this second wave then in cognitive behavior therapy. And then we have this third wave, which is a mishmash of all kinds of things. But one way to summarize it is to say that it's not so much changing the content of the cognitions, but changing one's reaction to having them. So instead of being upset at being upset, so that a lot of people, for example, come to see me not because they're depressed or because they're anxious, but because they're angry at themselves for being depressed, or they're embarrassed about being stressed. So it's the emotional reaction to the first emotion that's causing the problem. And this third wave of cognitive behavior therapy really emphasizes that in terms of don't emotionally react to your emotions, just passively experience them. View them as you would a bystander, viewing another person's feelings. Observe them. Don't get caught up in them. Don't get carried away. And don't necessarily try to change the first emotional reaction. Stick with it and don't blame yourself for having it. So mindfulness techniques evolve from this approach. Being in touch with one's own feelings and consciousness, especially in a non-critical way. I'd like you as well just to read on page 10 a modern version of a psychiatrist or a psychologist, not sure who it is, talking about a person that has OCD in terms of the feelings that they have when they touch, in quotes, a contaminated object. So you know what OCD contamination is. There's usually two types of OCD, one involving the idea of checking and rituals of checking and counting, and another type that involves fears of contamination. So touching something that other people have touched and feeling as a result of that, that you're dirty and therefore you have to wash repeatedly. And you have to wash 10 or 12 times. And the question is, why do you have to wash 10 or 12 times? Why isn't the first time good enough? So he goes on, and I'll let you read this, describing what a patient feels like and is thinking to themselves as they're doing this washing, and what they're aiming for in terms of feeling good, that the 10th washing has been sufficient. And what I would argue after you reading this piece, that this third wave bears a lot of similarity to what Watson initially rejected, which is the idea of this introspection. That this third wave is very much involving the conscious experience of the patient to their feelings, to their perceptions. And in a certain case, we've come full circle. The very thing that Watson objected to now becomes a standard part of our therapy. In page 11, I talk about some of the key attributes of cognitive behavior therapy. And again, I think you're going to have examples of these things. And then you can have examples where it doesn't apply, but nonetheless. So the procedures, for example, they tend to be clearly specified. The example of that that's the most sophisticated would be the treatment manual. So here's the 15-page manual about how to deal with somebody with panic. Here's step by step. Here's what you do on the first session, the second session, the third session, all laid out. And you can give it to a nurse, and she could be an expert or he in cognitive behavior therapy and dealing with panic as a result of the manual. So they're scientifically based, that we try to evaluate this treatment manual compared to other standardized treatment interventions. The assumptions about patients is interesting. I like cognitive behavior therapy for a number of reasons, and one of the reasons that I like it is that we try not to blame patients. And I know that sounds ridiculous to you because you're not professionals, but I grew up in an era where we talked disparagingly sometimes about people that came to see us. And we gave them disparaging labels such as borderline, assuming that the person can't be helped, or they were a pain in the ass, and so we call them a borderline patient. And cognitive behavior therapy changed that. They changed that for a number of reasons, and autism is one good example of that, where if you go to a conference in the field of autism, the audience is made up of either parents of autistic kids or autistic people with autism themselves. So there's no separation between them and us, you know, that we're all in this together. And that's an approach that I like. And the assumption is that behavior therapy deals with people who have a can't kind of problem, that they would like to do something but feel like they can't do something. And they're not very good in dealing with won't problems. In other words, somebody that comes in and says, you know, I just don't like people. And you ask them why, and said, I don't know, people are not, I just don't like them, they turn me off. It's hard to deal with that kind of situation versus somebody that says, you know, when I talk honestly to somebody, they use that information against me and I don't know what to do. then it becomes a can't problem. It becomes, they're lacking a skill or an ability that I could teach them to help deal with the problem. So we assume that patients are trying their best, and we try to help them, and we assume that a lot of the problems they have are can't problems rather than won't. The approach to patients, I said it's a collaborative approach, it's pragmatic, we try to use scientific procedures. In the last 2 minutes, let me look at some of the problems. I mentioned early on the idea of over-specialization. I think that's a real problem. And I give you an example of probably the arguably one of the best physicians in the world, Hippocrates, 2,000 years ago, who did everything with the patient. I mean, he investigated where they were living, what they ate, their exercise patterns. He would taste their urine. He would do everything involved and try to help the patient. I know it sounds gross, but the point is that he wasn't narrowly specialized. You go to a doctor right now and they'll do an MRI of your toe and they don't talk about your liver. And we're having the same thing in cognitive behavior therapy, I think, where that people over-specialize and they tend to see unique areas where there are commonalities. There are a lot of commonalities between a schizophrenic delusional patient and somebody, I think, with bulimia, although on the surface they seem very different, but underneath there are some common values that we need to appreciate. That's why I like, in the next page, I talk about the unifying theory of Barlow. Barlow, a psychologist, very famous, who is trying to develop sort of overarching diagnostic categories that, regardless whether you come in with a phobia or OCD, that if at your core you've got a common problem. And what we do in therapy has a commonality across many types of interventions. And so you can read about that in page 14. The last problem area is that we don't help everybody. And that's the difficulty, isn't it? If somebody comes in to see us and we're not able to help everybody, I think that's a difficulty. So I'll be back next week. I look forward to meeting you. And Molly's going to help you now assemble into groups. Okay, thank you.